thank you very much for inviting me. It's a real pleasure to be here. Thank you very much for turning up today at 9 a.m. on a Sunday morning. It's the level of commitment that we don't really get here in England, so thank you very much. So I'm going to talk to you today about understanding denial in sexual offenders. My background, so this is a couple of pictures of me. And on a night out last night, someone said I can't even remember this guy's name. Stoyer, I think. And actually, the guy, when he's wearing glasses, he does look quite a bit like me. So this is me. I'm from Nottingham Trent University. My speciality is in sexual offender. I've done a lot of research and work with sexual offenders. And I'm very interested in rehabilitation of offenders in general, actually. And I've also consulted a lot with the National Offender Management Service. They're the kind of body back in England and Wales that are responsible for the rehabilitation of offenders. And I've consulted specifically with them on the issue of denial in sexual offenders. And that's what I'm going to be talking about today. And hopefully it'll have resonance for your own kind of work and practice. Hopefully it'll give you something kind of new to think about, or the current thinking that we have to do with denial in sexual offenders. Hopefully as well, even if you're not interested in the rehabilitation of sexual offending, that it'll have kind of resonance with your own kind of work and practice. So I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the issues associated with denial in sexual offending. One other thing that I really want to talk about is a move from intuition, which I guess is, when we think about it in terms of effective practice, it's the stuff we think should have an effect in terms of rehabilitation, but actually doesn't. And denial is one of those key issues. When we think about denial, we kind of think, well, this really should be something that actually matters in terms of rehabilitation. But one of the things that I'm going to try and talk to you about today is actually it doesn't matter, or it doesn't matter in the way that we think it should matter. And I'm going to try and talk about that in terms of then moving towards evidence-based practice and treatment. In everything that we do in terms of treatment intervention has to be evidence-based practice. It has to be based on the best available evidence at the time. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that as well. I'm going to talk about the relevance of denial for the treatment process and whether it should actually matter to the treatment process as well. I think before I kind of talk about that, I'll talk a little bit about some of the context and definitions to do with denial in sexual offenders. So the context is in England and Wales, and I think it's fairly consistent when you start when you go to kind of North America and places like that, but around about half of the sex offenders that are incarcerated in prison tend to refuse treatment. And denial is found to be one of the main reasons why people refuse treatment. Around about a third of sexual offenders are in total denial, and the total deniers are the guys that say, you know, I didn't do it, I wasn't there, it's that kind of thing. And it's usually that variable that's important for treatment. Usually total deniers are excluded from treatment. If you're minimizing slightly, saying things like, oh, well, this happened, but well, actually that didn't quite happen like that, those minimizations are typically allowed on treatment. So total deniers are excluded from traditional treatment. And that makes them a resource issue. They typically serve longer sentences. It's harder for them to move between different prison establishments. It's harder for them to show that they've effectively managed their risk. So it's harder for them to kind of progress through the system. And when we think about this, often when you're kind of dealing with denial, it's a little bit like the unstoppable force meets the immovable object, because the first thing usually when we think about traditional practice is that denial should be something that needs to be overcome. Often people say things like it needs to be challenged, we need to break through denial. And it's usually the language like that that I think actually works quite counterproductive to effective correctional practice. And some of this comes down to the traditional models of doing treatment. So if you think about the cognitive behavioural model, the causes of behaviour are uncovered by a functional analysis of the behaviour, what preceded it and what reinforced it. And that can be problematic. So we'll talk a little bit about defining and conceptualizing denial, then I'll move on and talk a little bit about the function of denial. So the American Psychological Association defines denial as a defense mechanism in which a person fails to acknowledge some aspects of external reality that would be apparent to others. Usually when we look at definitions of denial, it's things like a failure to accept responsibility. ATSA, which is a kind of major organisation in North America, Canada, so the Association for the Treatment of Sexual Abusers, When they think about the denial, it's the failure of sexual abusers to accept responsibility for their offences. And often accepting responsibility is used as a synonym for denial. Actually, it isn't, because you think about denial, denial is an actual refutation. You're refusing to acknowledge something. Whereas failing to accept responsibility, well, that kind of encompasses a whole range of things. And I'll talk a little bit about why I think that's important in the next few slides. And this is because denial has often been conceptualised as either being either or, people are in denial or they're not in denial, or on a continuum. So some people have argued that it's on a continuum of distorted cognitions. So minimising the impacts of sexual assault, externalising blame, low acknowledgement of sexual behaviour problem and its impacts, they're seen as minimisations, as on this continuum of distorted cognitions. There is an inherent problem with that, though, however, in that the notion of a continuum requires the variable to have a number of levels and for someone to progress through those levels in a kind of logical order from low to high intensity or from high to low intensity. And it's difficult to see that when we talk about minimisations in terms of denial. So when we think about this, it's often been seen as thinking it was more sophisticated to see denial as existing on a continuum, but actually this concept increases ambiguity. And when we think about effective treatment, it's usually total denial. So I wasn't there, I didn't do it, which is the kind of main variable. This is the variable that excludes people from participating in treatment. And there's really no evidence to suggest that denial is actually continuous. So the very limited research that's been done on this, so Gibbons, DeVolder and Casey found no difference between offence type and denial type, and actually found the spread of denial to be quite variable. And again, it's remembering that total denial is the important variable for treatment. And I think actually thinking about denial, we need to think about it from a more kind of human position. So we all do denial all the time. It's kind of, it's a ubiquitous part of being a human being, really. And some social psychologists have argued that denial can be seen as a transitory phenomenon. It's a form of social scaffolding. So when we think about scaffolding, you think about when you use scaffolding, it's often when your kind of building is in a bit of a state of disrepair. You'll put the scaffolding up, that allows you to kind of work on the building. The scaffolding is then taken down. The problem is, when we think about this in terms of sexual offenders, denial and practice, we don't do a lot of work on the building. We don't do a lot of work with the individual, which often means the scaffolding's left erected. It often means that there's been no chance to bring the scaffolding down because we've done no meaningful work with the individual. Because most of our early interactions with people that are in denial are things like, well, you're in denial then, right, it means you can't do this program, or it's confrontational. And because it's confrontational, there's not the opportunity for us to kind of work on removing the scaffolding. And I think also that's important because it leads me to this next part about thinking about the function, context, and normalizing denial. So as I've kind of alluded to already, the traditional view of denial is that it's maladaptive. It's a signifier of poor insight. It needs to be broken down. We need to be able to break through denial. This is the kind of important things for clinical practice. I was doing some research, and one of the things that clinicians would often say to me is, well, deniers feel risky. I may not be a risk factor, but when someone's saying they aren't doing an offence, or they didn't do an offence, it feels risky. It feels risky. May not be risky, but it feels risky. This is the intuition that I was talking about, and we'll kind of discuss that later on. And it's also a thing that deniers are seen as having a kind of low motivation for treatment. But actually, when we think about the function of denial, and when we think about the function for ourselves, it performs many functions. So in some research that I did, we looked at why people denied and why people came out of denial. One of the kind of crucial elements of this was being able to maintain a viable identity and a coherent sense of self. One of the things, more than any other offence when we think about sexual offending, is that when you admit it, you lose an awful lot. You lose family, you lose friends, you lose status. And it's very, very hard to get that back. In fact, usually they say things like, well, the whole being, the whole person that I was gets destroyed when I say I did it. So that's a massive kind of psychological impact admitting an offence has. So it has impacts for the self, it has impacts for the family. But actually, denial helps to kind of function and maintain self-esteem and psychological well-being. And it can be an adaptional, an adaptational defense mechanism to perceived adversarial settings. And what I mean by that is, often denial is a cost-benefits analysis. So you weigh it up in terms of scales. You think, okay, if the consequences are high for admitting something, then, and kind of at the other end of that, if the outcome of that means that I may, one, get away with it, may, two, maintain a self-esteem, then denial is seen as a kind of pathway to kind of, what's the kind of word I'm looking for? To kind of maintain that kind of coherent sense of self. And I think the important thing is to say that we all do it. And this is something that we forget when we start thinking about this in practice. So I'm sure there's kind of times in all of our lives where we kind of, you know, bury our head in the sand, or, you know, we might get some bills coming and you know, final reminders for credit cards or things like that, and we'll kind of put it off. We'll kind of deny to ourselves that it's a problem. So it kind of happens all the time, really. Kind of another time is kind of at Christmas time, you know, we might overindulge in eating the cake, and we might eat a lot and overindulge over Christmas, and then we'll get on the scales and we'll be like, well, the floor's a bit uneven, so it's not really a true representation of my weight. It's in the morning and I'm always heavier in the morning, so again, it's not a true representation. So we do these kind of face-saving maneuvers, we do denial all the time. So I think it's important when we do effective work with any kind of offender that's in denial, but I'm obviously talking specifically about sexual offenders, is that we kind of normalise denial. There's a tendency for us to think that it's something that needs to be challenged, but actually, as I'm sort of saying really, you know, denial can be psychologically soothing. And excuse making is actually a highly adaptive way of coping with stress and kind of maintaining a good self-esteem. And also as well, we've evolved to be good self-deceivers. That's kind of what makes us part of the dominant species, really. Our way of being able to play social poker with people. You know, when you first meet people in a group, we seldom reveal our true nature of ourselves or our true feelings. We'll do little bits of denial. We might distort certain perceptions. When you first go on a date with someone, very rarely will you be completely honest. You know, you'll present yourself in a much more positive light. A little bit like if you see people's profiles on dating things. Soft focus lighting, everyone looks great. People present themselves as having amazing hobbies. Yeah, I'm a qualified pilot, I hand glide, I do all this kind of thing. And it's to present yourself in a more positive light. Very rarely do people have such qualifications. I think also as well, one of my favorite psychologist, psychiatrist, he's a master therapist in any case, Irving Yalom, states that never take away anything from a client unless you have something better to offer. Beware of stripping a patient who cannot bear the chill of reality. Actually taking away someone's defense mechanism, someone's denial, before they're ready to kind of move on in that kind of psychological process can actually be quite inherently damaging. And we can see this again to kind of labour a point a little bit, and that denial's quite normal. There's this film called The Invention of Lying. I don't know if you've seen it, probably not. Ricky Gervais isn't going to win any Oscars for this performance. But what he does state, and it's quite interesting, in this is a world where people can't lie. So you say to your partner, do I look fat in this? They don't turn around and say, no, you look great. They turn around and say, yeah, you do. He's the only person in this world that can lie, which gives him almost godlike powers. And there's this quite touching scene where his mum's dying. And he turns round to his mum and he's like, don't worry, mum. When you die, you're going to a place where there's fields. You can run, you can jump. You'll see dad, it's the best place. You'll have a mansion. And it brings a great deal of comfort. So, you know, and this is the kind of thing that I'm saying. So, when we think about denial and related phenomenon, this is often a kind of thing that is not only about presenting yourself, but can also be quite beneficial to others as well. And this is a picture of my actual son. This is supposed to say, I didn't eat the ice cream. But this is Google Translate, so it could literally say anything. I have absolutely no idea. But hopefully it comes across. So anyone that has experience with young children will know that we are quite adept at denying and deceiving from a young age. Now, my son would often come to me with chocolate or ice cream around the face, and this could be as young as kind of like 3 years old, and you'd say things like, have you eaten some ice cream? Have you had some cake? And he'll turn around and he'll be like, no, Daddy, no, I've not eaten it. I'm not a bad dad, he's not going to get beaten or anything, but he knew that he shouldn't have eaten it. He knew that he shouldn't have had the cake, he knew he shouldn't have had the sweets, even at a young age. And so he'll deny. He'll say, no, I didn't have it. It's almost like, what makes you think that? And it's like, but the stuff around your face, darling. So we all do it from a young age. So it's important to be mindful of the context. And context matters when we think about denial, because actually, not only in forensic environments, but also other environments, medical professionals, for example, you know, will label people in denial if you're not accepting of a certain diagnosis. So context matters, and I think that's why in forensic we kind of see it as important. But as we go through this talk, hopefully it'll be clear that it's not as important in the ways that we think it is. Also in terms of context, I don't know what it's like here, but often the reporting of sexual crimes is pretty horrific, really. And there's no other group that faces such kind of indignation as sexual offenders. Anything that happens, you'll see it in the newspapers, you know, beast, sex offender, pervert. Back home a few years ago, one of the papers with less of a reputation, the News of the World, started to publish names of paedophiles. Now, there's only one problem with that. The people that were doing it weren't very intelligent, and the readers less so. So what was happening was you were starting to get paediatricians being attacked. And that's not a joke. So actual paediatricians were being attacked because they were being thought of as that they were paedophiles, which in itself kind of like makes no sense at all. So in the terms of the context is very kind of highly rarefied. It's very hostile towards sex offenders. So even by thinking about that, you can see why a lot of offenders deny their actions. In fact, if anything, really, we need to be thinking about why would people admit? And if you've got a guy who's admitting it and saying, yeah, I did it, he's probably also saying, yeah, I did it, and it was great, and I loved it, and I'd do it again. Be more cautious of the guys that freely admit than the guys that freely deny, I would say. And one of the things that I kind of get thrown at me is when I talk about denial is that we often want offenders to admit because it helps the victim. It helps the victim kind of get over things. And I completely get that point as well. And it's not an important point to lose. And I guess there's always that trade-off. But I think one of the best ways that we can prevent victims, and particularly future victims, is by doing meaningful, constructive work with the individual. And one of this, when we think about this in terms of therapeutic practice, and one of the suggestions is that even just entering into a kind of therapeutic relationship, is that the very entry into a therapeutic relationship permits the client to entertain or to try out possibilities that provide a temporary means by which to reconfigure the worldview. So basically what I mean by that is just by engaging into a therapeutic practice with individuals can help that kind of process of change. Even if on the outside it seems like they're making no progress because they're still denying. So we've talked about the context and the function of denial, and hopefully I'm kind of making that point that it's quite a natural, normal human phenomenon. And this brings us to kind of our first look at kind of practice, which is when we, at the moment, in a lot of jurisdictions, is based on intuition. Intuition's that kind of thing is, well, it should matter, but actually doesn't matter. Intuition in correctional practice has also been termed correctional quackery. It's focusing on things that don't have a strong evidence base. And denial in sexual offenders, so reducing denial, has absolutely no evidence base whatsoever. There's no good evidence out there to suggest that we should spend an awful lot of time getting people out of denial. In fact, the reverse could said to be true. We might want to spend time getting people into denial because it seems that it's actually more protective. And I'll kind of explain that point in a little bit further on. So intuitive beliefs are those that are based on anecdotal evidence rather than empirical evidence, and they're the ones that have been termed correctional quackery. Where do they come from? Well, it often comes from a feel. It feels like it should matter. Prevailing cultural, religious, and moral imperatives. So there's probably an argument that actually there's a big kind of Western Christian element to wanting to people to admit. One of the things we get taught from a young age is don't lie, is always admit, is tell the truth all the time. And it may be those kind of sentiments related to that make it so that we actually want people to admit. There is a real wanting to kind of people to admit when they've done wrongdoing. And with this, it brings these kind of feelings that deniers are higher risk or that deniers are risky. But is responsibility needed? So McGrath and colleagues found that 91% of treatment programs in the US included offender responsibility as a treatment target. And furthermore, over a third of those programs required full disclosure by the end of the program. So what this basically shows us, and it's quite similar, it used to be in England and Wales, that most treatment programs will focus quite heavily on non-criminogenic targets. And non-criminogenic targets include things like denial and minimization, excuse making, offence disclosure, offence accounts, and recently as well, victim empathy. These elements are the ones that we spend quite a bit of time on, and are the ones that have the lowest evidence base. And this has led people to develop other programs. So for example, Bill Marshall created a program which looked at admitting total deniers in, and he approached it from the angle of, well, how about we create a program whereby we can put you in a position where you can never be accused of a sexual offence again. So looking at it from that angle. And one of the things that I've argued is that in a lot of treatment programs, and particularly so with sex offender treatment programs, confession is almost an organising principle of treatment. And again, it's thinking about why do we think that's important. One of the reasons why we think that's important is that often people coming out of denial is seen as a marker for progress. So if people are saying the right kind of things, that means that they are making progress. If people are denying, it means that they are not making progress. Again, this could be related to moral, religious, cultural imperatives or positions. And there's also a belief that without congruence between the offender's version of events and those of recorded versions, treatment will be more difficult and more likely than not ineffective. But again, there's no evidence for this. This is again based on intuition. Offence accounts. We often spend a lot of time getting people to do offence accounts. And this is because we expect offender disclosure to be again a marker of progress. But often it is not. I did some research looking at the perspectives and experiences of those that treat deniers and looking at the treatment and management of that. And one of the things, I won't go into every detail about what came out of those interviews, but the two themes that I'll focus on are frustrating and rewarding and beliefs about deniers. And I'll very quickly kind of talk through this. So the first kind of key theme was about frustration and reward. So the things that were coming out in these interviews were things like, well, I find it quite frustrating actually when they stay in denial, although I don't show it to them, you know, but it happens when they've gone and I'm back in the office and I'll kick chairs around. It's dead frustrating. It's really frustrating. And I think this is quite an important one with Sally. This isn't their real names. I've noticed some people can see it as a victory for themselves if they can push someone out of denial, and a failure if they don't. It's that, again, that kind of implacable position where it's about trying to shift or move someone out of a position. And here, this is kind of exemplified by Trevor, who says, I could have, like, had him there. That was a good chance, and I missed that. But there's a big rewarding element getting them to move. And that, again, thinking about that therapeutic relationship is, you know, I could have had him. There was a time when he was starting to admit, and if I'd have pressed a bit more, I could have had him. It's very... it's a very adversarial way of working with individuals, especially when it's got absolutely no evidence. So participants' frustrations, so clinicians' frustrations, are often about moving or not moving people out of a position. Often we're wanting people to say what we think is a version of the truth. And continued denial was seen as a lack of insight. It's the personal battles that kind of caused the frustration. And the rewards, the personal victories, were seen as shifting people out of denial. There was also a lot of entrenched beliefs about deniers as well. And this was often about, well, can we do meaningful clinical work with those that are in denial? And so Trevor says, the pure, blatantly, no sexual element whatsoever. Again, there's no point in working with them because there's no sexual element. In terms of treatment for them, I would make a cut-off point and say someone who's like in pure denial, they shouldn't do treatment. I think that's quite a bold claim, but it's not an uncommon one. This is quite a common, popular point of view, I think, from a lot of people that work with this client group. And so for those, so deniers that can't go on treatment, again, this is an individual saying if they don't go on treatment, it's going to raise their risk. And that in itself is a bit of a fallacy, that actually, if you don't go on treatment, it somehow raises your risk. That's not entirely true. And then I know it's not supposed to be a factor, but it seems risky. I don't know, it just feels risky. It's again, that intuition, it feels risky. But what does the evidence tell us? So we've talked a little bit about intuition and how those things feel, but what does the actual evidence say? So first of all, are deniers different from admitters? Well, there's some very, very limited research that has looked at differences between those that typically admit and those that typically deny. Some deniers have been found to minimize all aspects of psychopathology. That becomes quite a difficult thing for clinicians to work with if they're denying absolutely everything, denying any kind of psychological problem. In my experience, that's not the case, though. Most deniers actually have a long list of things that you could work on, not necessarily to do with their sexual offending, but things that are risk factors related to that. A colleague of mine, Ware, who's done quite a lot of research in denial as well, has found that deniers tend to be kind of older, have lower IQ, and more likely to be child molesters. And deniers report significantly higher levels of shame and fear of negative consequences. And that itself is really important, this idea of shame and shame management. Particularly think that's important for sexual offenders. I've recently written a chapter looking at emotions and effect in sexual offenders. And we find that actually shame is about thinking about things, it's inward, and it motivates kind of defensive positions. Whereas if we can move people towards experiencing guilt, that's more likely to, they're more likely to experience wanting to make amends. So it's important to minimise shame and understand the fear of negative consequences. But what about in terms of, you know, when we think about evidence-based practice, and what we really want to know is what's associated with recidivism, really? Stops people from reoffending in the future. So most research finds no overall effect for denial. So denial does not seem to predict recidivism by itself. Meta-analyses and all the various research has never found it to be to have an overall effect on recidivism. And neither denial or minimizations are criminogenic. So there's no evidence that an increase in accepting responsibility leads to a reduction in reoffending. And I think that's an important point to kind of make. Although there are some bits of research that kind of give us, when we start to look at in terms of groups, that help us to understand denial slightly more nuanced. So for example, Noons and colleagues found that low risk, but only low risk incest offenders were more likely to recidivate if they were high in denial. However, this effect disappeared when they controlled for things like psychopathy. So when they were considered, denial had no overall effect. Harkins, Beach and Goodwill found that those that were high risk and high denial had decreased recidivism, while those that were low risk and in high denial were increased recidivism. The problem with that study is the way they defined denial was accepting responsibility. It was a very small sample, so it was hard to kind of draw some kind of conclusions from that. So the research at present is not sufficient enough for us to say anything about denial and recidivism. It may be a risk factor for some. If it is, it's more likely to be low risk and low risk incest offenders. And nearly all the research is done pre-treatment. So there's none looking at people's journeys and progression through treatment. That's probably because not many deniers go through treatment or looking at things post-treatment. When we look at the interaction with risk, Marshall and colleagues found denial to be negatively related to items on three risk measures, suggesting that denial actually may predict a lower chance of reoffending. And that kind of makes sense in a way. If we think about that in terms of a narrative psychological position, if you've got someone who's denying or rejecting the sex offender label or putting distance between themselves and the sex offending label and instead presenting a identity which is, you know, I'm a good person, I'm a person of good standing. We think about from a narrative psychological point of view, people tend to live up to the stories that they tell about themselves. So it may be that for some individuals, denial is protective because they are living up to that kind of outward presentation of I'm a good person, I'm a moral person. And this is quite a good recent paper looking at the relationship between denial, risk and recidivism. I've done a little arrow to where it says offender types. So for specific offender types, denial of responsibility was not associated with increase in sexual recidivism or in violent recidivism. So it seems to be the same for violence as well. And crucially, when we think about this, working constructively with this client group, we want to think about, does denial impede targeting empirically supported risk factors? So we think about the risk-need responsivity model. Andrews and Bonta come with the central eight, those eight risk factors that are associated with recidivism. They're things like the first four are basically around antisociality, antisocial attitudes, antisocial associates, antisocial behavioral history, antisocial personality disorder, family and intimate relationships or the lack thereof, employment, the lack thereof, use of leisure time. So when we think about that in terms of a protective factor, we often talk about a constructive use of leisure time has been a good thing for offenders, and sobriety, substance misuse. When we map that over to empirically supported risk factors for sexual offenders, they're things like deviant sexual interest, offence-supportive attitudes, grievance and hostility, a lack of emotionally intimate relationships with adults, lifestyle impulsivity, poor problem-solving, negative social influences, again, that link to antisociality. What we're seeing here is that if we think about it, a lot of these factors can be addressed without the need to ever admit anything, without the need to ever admit that they were there, that they did an offence. In fact, if we left the sexual offence element out of it, and that's where the programmes are going in England and Wales with the new programmes, we're taking a lot of the sex or the focusing on the offence specific stuff out of it. If we move that out of it, there's a whole host of key risk factors that we can address without that need for admittance. And I take it, you know, some of this is quite, you know, controversial and sometimes not popular. So it's fine to kind of like disagree with it and that's absolutely fine. And I think now we've kind of moved from intuition to evidence and we think about this and we've seen the evidence is that denial isn't related to recidivism. In fact, when you have a closer look at the literature, actually, denial seems to be protective for sexual offenders rather than it being maladaptive. It's important to kind of understand why that actually might be the case. So some of the research that I did focused on looking at people's transition from denial towards admittance. And one of the things, or a few of the things that came out that were really important were things like maintaining viable identities and also this kind of personal journey and change. So when people stayed in denial, it was often because, so the main reason I denied was thinking that no one in the world would ever want to speak to me again. I think that's quite a kind of powerful thing, really, thinking that no one in the world, if I was to admit this, no one in the world would ever want to speak to me again. Just, if you think about that, how isolating that must feel, how kind of on the edge of society you must feel is massive, really. What's the worst thing you can say to someone? I'm Hitler. It would have been easier if I'd have murdered her, less stigma. So again, this is that kind of idea that actually it's the worst of the worst. If I was to say this, then people are going to think of me as a monster. Some people say it's almost like a lifetime tag. You know, sex offenders gives you the impression they'll have this tag for life. And often as well, when you talk to deniers, it's that kind of personal revulsion. So I think sex offenders are disgusting. I'm disgusted with myself. So a lot of it was about maintaining or being able to maintain a viable identity. One of the things when I was consulting with the National Offender Management Service was we need to create opportunities for people to construct and maintain viable identities. Getting rid of denial, so the presentation of such an identity meant a fear of loss, a fear of being rejected by family and friends. And often it was about a lot of the people who had gone through denial had created a new identity, had restored their lives, and were now subscribing to things that we might call redemption scripts. And redemption scripts are, I suppose, narrative scripts where you kind of reconstruct yourself as, you know, I'm essentially a good person that's done bad things and I want to kind of make amends. And I did a paper looking at making sense of denial. If anyone wants any of these papers or any kind of resources, or they're interested in some of the specifics related to this, do feel free to get in contact with me. And I'll kind of email you the papers that I've got. So one of the things I looked at was from a narrative psychological position, was looking at the narratives of denial. So often we say with deniers that they distance themselves from the sex offender label, they rejected that label. And they had a desire to put across good and moral selves. And if we think about this, so narrative psychology tells us we make sense of our lives through stability and change. So I am the same person that I was 6 months ago. I'm a different person than I was 6 months ago. This happens, generally speaking, when we go through turning points in our life. You might have become a parent. You might have moved house. You might have moved to a different country. These are all turning points that allow a narrative change. When you're presenting a stable narrative, it means you're seeing yourself as consistent. So deniers were very much concerned with putting forward kind of desirable identities and moral identities. And it's been argued in narrative terms that stability narratives present the individual as kind of consistent, as good, and this can facilitate the enacting of those roles. And what I mean by that is that kind of you live up to those roles. And this brings a kind of relational element. So when we kind of think about resistance to being labeled a sex offender, that's actually probably a good thing. You know, we probably don't want people to internalize those labels because it leaves people with an impaired position in terms of being able to maintain self-respect or self-esteem. So when we think about that in terms of a narrative, if you think about personal reform, if we think about personal change, actually, personal change is a distortive process itself. It's based on denial. When we expect offenders to go through offender change, that in itself really is a kind of process of denial and distortion. We want people to accentuate elements that are good about themselves and kind of push down the ones that are perhaps not so good about themselves. And it's relational denial because it only happens in relation with other people. Well, as I've kind of mentioned in that last slide, so personal reform and rehabilitation may itself be a kind of cognitive distortion of sorts, really. And it may be protective if the denier is engaged in positive behaviour elsewhere. So, for example, they might be working on the wings of their prison, doing kind of peer support work. They might be engaged in education, they might be engaged in something. If you can evidence behaviour change elsewhere where they're doing positive stuff, that in itself might be protective. So lastly, I'll talk a little bit about effective practice, and I'll kind of leave it then to some questions. Traditional treatment approaches with deniers have often been about shifting people out of admittance. And in fact, early programmes were all about shifting people from denial out of admittance. There was an early treatment program in America where they got people and they had to be admitting, and that was the kind of aim. And at the end of the program, over half the people who were in total denial were admitting. The problem with it was highly coercive. Basically, if you were admitting at the end of the program, you didn't have to pay for your therapy, and you also got a reduction in kind of something else. I forget what it was now. But if you were denying, you had to pay for therapy and you also had to go and do more therapy. So it was highly coercive. In England, in the probation service, when they were developing a deniers program, it started off as being confrontational, and Roberts and Baim say it would be an understatement to say that it led to a degree of work frustration and despair. They were getting nowhere with it. It was just based on friction. So they changed their program to one of kind of psychological education. So it became almost psychological education program. And this feeds into this idea that we can address treatment needs without admittance. So the important question is, where do we go from here? So we have, the way I see it, we have three choices. We can do nothing, which is kind of what's happening now. But we really need to think about, is that acceptable? As people who work in forensic psychology, as forensic psychologists, is that really a good enough position? What does that actually say about us if we've got a group that we say we can do nothing with? Is that really acceptable? We could have deniers groups, which is about getting deniers all together and putting them on groups and doing treatment based on empirical risk factors. Or we can look at putting deniers onto regular treatment. Doing nothing is a position that I would say is just not tenable at all. It has no merit whatsoever, and I think reflects quite poorly us as forensic psychologists. They're also less likely to be offered early release, much more difficult to pass through the criminal justice system. And they might have outstanding needs post-release as well. We could put deniers onto regular treatment, and in some treatment programs they do this. They might put one or two deniers onto a program where there's a group of about eight individuals. There are some fears that this might damage group dynamics. And what we would have to do if you were to put deniers on groups would be to change the orientation of treatment somewhat. So treatment would have to move away from being disclosure orientated. And as I say, in England and Wales, we're making that transition, that leap, where we're moving away from things being disclosure orientated. So there are kind of challenges to this. That might be things like poor engagement, motivation, disruptiveness, but often these are kind of beliefs that we have about the process based on wanting people to make observable markers of change, wanting us for them to say the right kind of things. Sometimes deniers will say things like, well, they want to go on treatment because they feel quite suspicious about it. If they deny any problems, well, that's an issue, but actually through a good therapeutic alliance, working alliance, we can work with individuals, and they will start to kind of come with things that actually are things that we can target and that are related to risk factors. And we should see denial as a responsivity issue, that we're just not very responsive to. We don't really respond to this issue well at all. So one of the things that I would argue for is for treatment to become less sex offender, less consumed with sex. One of the kind of things that you will note when working with sex offenders, particularly those that have been through treatment, is more than any other group in the world, they talk about sex all the time. That was my deviant sexual attitudes. That was my negative sexual schemas. That I had my schema glasses on. Oh, that's when I had these thoughts about sex. Sex, 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 sex. You meet a sex offender, all they want to talk to you about is sex. In no other kind of therapy in the world would that kind of happen. And meeting people in real life, that would very rarely happen. Even with a group of close friends, would you always just go on about sex, 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 sex? So we need to make sex offender therapy less sex-focused. And there's no real coherent arguments why we can't do this, and there's no real coherent arguments why we can't let deniers onto regular treatment. And in fact, actually, this causal direction, if you like, of taking responsibility as a condition of personal change has been challenged. Seems that it's not the things that we think that matters to personal change that actually matters to personal change at all. Yes, you have to manage group dynamics and be aware of those things like resistance, and let's face it, nobody in life said it'd be easy, but the current position is one that is just not effective. And again, I think reflects poorly on us as a discipline. There's lots of constructive work. We go back to that slide about empirical risk factors. There's lots of things that you can do with sex offenders. And we can broaden that out from sexual offending to other types of offending groups as well. Lots of things that we can do without the need for admittance. And what this is all about, and these are my kind of final few slides really, kind of take home messages, is about working constructively with deniers. So we need to invest in therapeutic relationships. One of the things you'll find a lot with sex offenders, but particularly with those in denial, is that they lack trust. So it's about building trust, building effective, dare I say, even genuine relationships that are based on respect and rapport. Engaging in therapeutic relationships in of itself is likely to have a positive effect. And one thing for certain is we need to move beyond this kind of, it wasn't me, yes it was, kind of transaction. This is where the frustrations lie. And ultimately, this is what makes practice with deniers not effective at all. And in fact, it's just moving beyond that kind of counter-transference. So we can use different techniques, motivational interviewing, moving people. So often when we think about denial, denial might be a form of ambivalence, mixed feelings about where they're at the minute and where they want to be, mixed feelings about admitting. We can move away from things about being solely based on disclosure. We can permit deniers onto groups. And my kind of last point really is that denial, and I think this is true for most effective treatment with individuals, denial does not need to be the end game in sex offender treatment. And thank you very much for your time this morning. There's some references there. Happy to take any questions. And if people want any more information, do get in touch. And thank you very much for listening this morning. Thank you.
Bardzo dziękujemy za wykład. Jestem pewien, że macie Państwo jakieś pytania do Pana doktora.
What do I do? Put it in my ear.
Dzień dobry. Ja bym chciała się zapytać, czy są badania mówiąc o skuteczności tej terapii, ale w takim rozumieniu nie powrotu do recydywy, czyli nie popełnienia kolejnego przestępstwa o charakterze seksualnym.
Just one second. It's not okay.
Chciałabym się zapytać, czy były prowadzone badania mówiąc o skuteczności tak rozumianej terapii, ale w takim rozumieniu nie popełnienia kolejnego przestępstwa o charakterze seksualnym?
Could you just repeat that last bit, please? If I understand the question correctly, and I'm quite happy to go back to it if I haven't. So there's no evidence to suggest that denial has any impact in terms of recidivism. There is some research to suggest that the opposite might be true. So for example, if your denial might be related to lower risk of recidivism for a lot of kind of sex offender groups. The only bit of research that looks at denial and recidivism are things, the only bit of evidence that we can see is that low risk denial only for incest offenders seems to be related to increased recidivism. But there's no overall effects for denial and recidivism, and actually the opposite seems to be true. I don't know if that answers the question.
I think that one part of the question is also, are there any other efficiency measures of sex offender therapy rather than sex recidivism?
Say again, sorry. No, so can you repeat the question?
Are there any other measures of effectiveness of the therapy rather than sexual recidivism?
Okay, now I get it. Okay, so when we look at effectiveness, I think this is part of, I think, a failure in terms of forensic practice. When people look at effectiveness, they're often just looking at recidivism as markers for change. So we're interested in whether it has an effect. So in terms of other measures, there hasn't really been kind of other research that's looked at other measures. There've been some research that's looked at changes in personality, in terms of self-esteem, But they haven't been used in intervention. So they haven't been used in intervention, but there have been other measures looking at denial and what that kind of means for practice, but not in terms of evaluating the outcome.
Panie doktorze, mam duże doświadczenie prawne i w roli ofiary, może mniejsze psychologiczne, ale wczorajszy wykład o poligrafii nasunął mi taką myśl, że być może poligraf byłby dobrym narzędziem, moje pytanie, poligraf byłby dobrym narzędziem w ujawnieniu zjawiska zaprzeczenia, ponieważ wczoraj na wykładzie była mowa, że przy przestępstwach o charakterze seksualnym nie ma wymogu obligatoryjnego jakby badania poligrafem, a uważam, że przy zjawisku, tak pomyślałam, zaprzeczenia, poligraf mógłby to ujawnić, że przestępca wypiera to, a tu ma jawne jakby badanie, że jednak popełniony został ten czyn.
That's a really good point. In England and Wales, the polygraph is used in probation settings, and it's used as a way of facilitating effective community management. So it's used as a way of facilitating truth in some respects, and to kind of get disclosures about, say, risky behaviours. So it's used in probation, looking at trying to detect risky behaviours. So I take the point that we could use the polygraph to kind of detect denial. My kind of concern with that would be it kind of goes against the evidence. So if we're using the polygraph to try and shift people out of denial, we could argue that that's could be counterproductive for the therapeutic relationship. And actually there's no evidence, again it's going back to this thing about evidence, there's no evidence to suggest that we need to get people out of denial. So while we may feel better about getting people out of denial, if we're taking something away from these individuals, denial might be having an important function for them at that particular time. I guess I would question the kind of therapeutic aspects of that really. And so it's probably not something that I'd be in favour of. But I think in terms of community supervision, I think it has a place. I think it has a role. Would be my opinion.
Ja akurat jestem właśnie osobą, która wykonuje badania na poligrafie i chciałabym, żeby w Polsce były takie badania wprowadzone właśnie w nadzór i monitoring osób popełniających przestępstwa na tle seksualnym. Dlatego, że myślę o ofiarach, to znaczy rozumiem podejście terapeutyczne, żeby nie wyprowadzać z różnych przyczyn właśnie z tego zaprzeczenia, ale chodzi mi przede wszystkim o to, żeby móc również włączyć terapię ofiary. Czyli jeżeli nie wyprowadzamy zaprzeczenia, to nie mamy informacji o ofiarach. W tym momencie chodzi też o czas, tak? Czyli jeżeli stosujemy poligraf, czyli mamy dostęp do informacji o ofiarach. I tu myślę przede wszystkim właśnie również o ofiarach, które nam pozwolą, to takie informacje pozwolą nam zająć się osobą, która jest ofiarą.
Yeah, I take the point about it being important for victims, and I can see how it could be used for that. And in fact, this is often something people will say to me: "But what about the victims? It leaves the victims not with a lot when you leave an offender in denial." And I get the argument, and I'm very sensitive to that argument. Again, for me though, I think the best way to do the victims justice is to try and ensure that there are no more victims. And we know that we have a really good idea of what works with offenders, sexual offenders, in terms of what works in terms of effective practice. And you know, this is just one argument that I'm putting forward, but denial isn't one of them. And in fact, if anything, denial might be having a positive effect for that offender. And so I just think we need to think very carefully before we start saying, okay, well, we can use lie detection to move people out of denial. Because we don't know if that's working to the benefit. We don't know actually what impact that could have in terms of where that offender is at. And we know it's not related to effective treatment. So I guess I'm just wary about using it in terms of moving people out of denial. If it was implemented more with a kind of therapeutic approach, then maybe. But I guess I'm just not convinced by the argument that we need to move people out of denial.
Just very shortly, I had experience of working with a person who was sexual offender, and actually he was in denial, and we were working with him in denial, but he was able to express really a lot through art. So all his sexuality he was able to express, not talking about it, but showing in art. So,
yeah.
So how we work with him.
I think that's that's excellent. And that's kind of the point I'm making, really, is that there's so many other constructive ways of working with, you know, offenders in general, sex offenders in general. But I think but allowing that kind of creativity and working, being responsive to that particular guy's needs and working and getting them to express it. And then the work that you can do with that, getting them to talk through aspects of what that represents, maybe challenging sensitively aspects of that, getting them to think about it. I think, yeah, that sounds fantastic.
Ja mam takie pytanie, czy spotkał się pan z taką sytuacją, że u sprawców poważnych przestępstw seksualnych, zabójców na tle seksualnym, może w niektórych przypadkach dojść do jeszcze silniejszego mechanizmu obronnego, jakim jest całkowite wyparcie, więc nie mówimy tylko o zaprzeczaniu, takim powiedzmy w celu ochrony własnego do własnej samooceny, ale po prostu wyparcie takie, że to, że tego nie zrobił, on rzeczywiście tego nie pamięta. Czy spotkał się pan z taką sytuacją?
Yes. That has happened. I mean, I suppose what I've been talking about is thinking about denial in the broader sense in terms of sexual offenders. But I think you're absolutely right. There are, I think, a very select amount where perhaps for the most serious serial sex crimes where there is an element of repression. And I think that does happen in terms of people kind of suppress that. Although really interestingly, there has been some research looking at treatment. In this treatment, they got people who said that they couldn't remember or had blackouts in terms of the offence. And they did a kind of, they packaged it as a repressive memory treatment. It actually wasn't at all. It was a kind of bogus therapy, really. And what they found is through that, people started admitting. So it's very difficult to know sometimes whether people are repressing, just lying, presenting it in kind of different ways. But it seems to be whether people are repressing it or saying they're repressing it, actually doing some kind of clinical work allows people to be able to start talking about it and allows people to move forward in the personal change process, if that makes sense.
Czy są jeszcze jakieś pytania? Nie widzę. W takim razie jeszcze raz bardzo serdecznie dziękuję panu.